Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to another segment of Asaph Cafe. I am your host, Asaph Adonai, and we're doing another taping of Asaph Cafe. We're in our virtual set, and I'm very humbled and very blessed to have this show and to share this with our viewing audience and with our guests today. And we'll start out with Emmett, who is our guest again. Mm-hmm. And we had him on the previous show, and it was just a delight to have him. And Linda Brooks Curtis, our regular, and I always appreciate having her on the show. She looks lovely with her green hat on. And this time we have our veteran guest and our hostess, Yay! Patty Reed.
This is that far saying happy Mother's Day.
And of course our mascot, Pee Wee. So we're all one big happy family on the ASAP Cafe.
Happy days are here again.
Yeah. And
Pee Wee had a hairdo done. Yes, yeah, she had her trim on. So she's all sexy now.
Short version of that song there.
Yep.
And Pee Wee just looks so cute on camera. And she's our mascot.
Yes, yes.
You know, when I first started doing the show almost a year ago, it just was the two brick walls.
Uh-huh.
Our original
set. I remember that, yeah.
Show. And then those two brick walls went to three brick walls, and it was expanding. And then we finally went to the virtual set, so we're doing virtual these days now on Asaph Cafe.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd like to do a live Asaph Cafe on location one day as soon as I find a real cafe.
Outside?
Yeah, an outdoor
on
location.
On the streets of Missoula.
Well, I was thinking of the Starving Artist Cafe over there on Reserve. I'm going to have to get their permission to see if they'll let me get in there with those cameras and do a taping.
I don't think I've been there.
Yeah, I played there a couple days ago. They have a patio with the tables and the outdoor umbrella. We can do the outside or maybe inside the
cafe. Is there a lot
cafe.
Of artists there?
Not really. It's just a restaurant. That's just what they call it. But it might be a perfect
anybody
location.
Who is in any art. Yes.
Well, it might be a perfect location
maybe
to do an Asaph Cafe. You know,
interesting.
On location. It'll be our first location show if I can get permission to do that. So we'll see. But in the meantime, we're in our little Vegas set here.
And it still looks beautiful, looks like something out of a dream. Like I said last week, dreams that I've had. And, you know, beautiful, beautiful.
Cause right. And,
what? This is angel food cake. You know, I had another dream a few years ago, and I wrote down in my dream diary where I was at this buffet of dessert. It was a dessert buffet I wandered into, and they were all beautiful cream cakes and little confections and beautiful gourmet cookies and gourmet brownies and gourmet chocolates, little cakes like this, all like $1,000, you know, to get in, but best desserts I ever had. Oh, they were just...
Sounds like a modern dream.
Yeah, yeah, just room after room after the best desserts. Just talk about sugar overload. It was a good dream, though.
Okay.
Delicious, delicious, you know.
So did you have a sweet day the day after you...
I don't know. I can't remember. But I just liked. I just liked the dream. It was very nice.
Well, thanks for being on our show again, Emmett. This is a delight to have you here. And oh, that meatloaf, wasn't that good?
Oh, delicious.
And the baked potato and the green beans.
Yeah, we have to thank the Missoula Senior
Center. Did you get some green beans?
Oh, yes, I did.
Yeah, well, let's make an acknowledgement to the Missoula Senior Center. They provided the
food
today.
Thank you.
They provided the food today for Asaph Cafe.
Nice.
And, it was really, really good food here.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm really
and
thankful.
And I want to make
that.
Another thank you.
What's that?
I appreciate and thank you, Celtic women singers and musicians, for taking the time to come here out of your busy schedule of 10th anniversary. You were marvelous. I enjoyed all of the special effects and everything you did. And it was a lot of effort, and I appreciate it. And it was one on the top upper half of the level,
well,
standing there cheering on.
I'm sure they're going to appreciate that plug. Thank you, hostess. Well,
and
anyway.
A thank you to the Missoula Eagles for providing and constructing and dedicating the Missoula Manor Homes 43 years ago. We celebrated the 43rd anniversary yesterday, June 10th, with a red, white, and blue theme. And John Nelson, about the founding of the manor and what it means to the Eagles and to the residents. kids and to the community, and he was choked up.
Okay. Yeah.
It was very heartfelt, and so we thank the Eagles and the community for supporting Missoula Manor Homes.
And one more thank you. Thank you, PBS, for sponsoring the Celtic Women. You're awesome. I love your channels. I watch them all the time.
Well, I'm
so
sure
much.
PBS appreciates that, and I'll do the plug. So, how are you today, Linda?
You know what? I was determined not to be sunburned, so I wore my Hawaiian shirt.
Hey, that's true.
I figured that would cool it down a little bit.
And it
new
has
Hawaiian
been
song.
Oh, Hawaiian love song.
Yeah. You know the song you meant?
No, I don't.
Played in a while. But Don Ho, getting back to him, I always liked him because, one, he had such a clean, wholesome image to me as a performer, and two, he sounded an awful lot like Dean Martin. Have you ever noticed that when he sang?
Easy listening, relaxed, laid back.
He had a very strong
and,
voice.
You know, his trademark also, like Lawrence Welk, was bubbles, you know, like when he was playing the piano.
Tiny bubbles.
Yeah, he would have bubbles
in
floating
line.
Up.
You can find him in the luau's everywhere.
By the way, maybe we should pray again over the food since we're continuing to eat. I always like to open this with prayer.
Go ahead. I'm just playing tiny bubbles as you pray. Go ahead.
Heavenly Father, in Jesus' name, thank you for another excellent show of Asaph Cafe since we're continuing to eat the food you've provided. Bless our time together. Bless again the food that you've provided us through their bounty through Christ our Lord. And may the souls of the faithfully departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
You know, I have to admit that in all the years I've been in music, I have never played Tiny Bubbles while somebody's playing a prayer.
But I know what you're praying for now. Bubbles!
No. Getting back to Bubbles, though. Don Ho had bubbles shooting out of the piano on occasion. He didn't have a candelabra on the piano. He had that big champagne glass. Do you remember that? And then the bubbles would shoot out. So that was his gimmick. And, of course, Lawrence Welk with the bubbles, too.
Well, with your kind of luck, you'd probably see Michael Jackson's chimpanzee, the bubbles.
I think
the bubble machine!
For me, no, I think the candelabra is good enough for me. But
and
well,
then,
we do that
then
too.
Plenty of it.
It was like my...
no pills about it.
My son's wedding... It wasn't Provo, it was in American Fork, Utah, and it was at a beautiful old church, and at the end of the ceremony, as we were leaving, people didn't throw rice, they blew bubbles.
Bubbles are awesome.
Bubble blowing.
That's what we were doing here, too.
Does anybody know that song?
Studio.
Yes.
Yeah. Do you recognize it?
My Three Sons.
That song just came to mind.
There's a lot of famous fathers.
My Three Sons.
Did you get enough potatoes?
Oh, yeah. You're still alive.
Did you get enough cake or some more, a little bit left? I don't think I have anything that's going to kill you. It's just a bite or two.
Did
you
get
some
potatoes, too? Your haircut looks good, baby.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, she's feeling sexy these days. She can just get the king and prince of her dreams.
you if there's just don't want the. Does anyone want any more of this food or?
No, if you guys want to eat the rest of that food,
I'll
go
eat the
for
rest
it.
Of the meatloaf.
Ooh, meatloaf.
Yeah, you can have some. You
I don't want
all.
Any. Meatloaf.
I'll eat the rest of the meatloaf.
All right.
I'm just after the potatoes and green beans. You know that.
Would you rather have the potatoes and green beans then, or whatever?
Yeah. No.
I'll take the green beans.
I don't need any of it.
I'll take the green beans. And
that's right.
All right.
I don't need any of it because I had a full lunch at the Manor before
take,
I came.
I'll take the green beans.
Oh, so you're double taken.
Yep.
I had a pastrami,
huh?
Pastrami.
Yeah, I know. That's funny how they always mention that, you know.
On gluten-free bread. Oh, my gosh. With a dash of horseradish.
Yeah, when I was in junior high, I sang this song repeatedly in school in the lunch line, but I changed the words. It was, I want to splash in a coffee cup and live in the washing machine. I want to splash in a coffee cup and live in a washing machine. It's all I want to do all day is live in a washing machine. It's all
well,
I want to
have fun with that. Why don't you sing that and I'll just play it.
All right.
And ready?
I sang in the lunch line to everyone. I want to splash in the... I want to splash in the coffee cup and live in a washing machine. I want to splash in a coffee cup and live in a washing machine. It's all I wanna do all day is live in a washing machine. It's all I wanna do all day is live in a washing machine. It's all I wanna do all day is live in a washing machine. Isn't that funny?
Yeah, it is.
Yeah.
That's cute. I gotta remember that.
Imagination.
Yep.
That's probably not too, about the same age that I was singing. I'm getting nothing for Christmas.
Oh, yeah.
Well, you know that song, that is really, I call it the underdog song.
Yes, yes.
Do you remember the underdog cartoon?
Yeah, you're telling me about the underdog.
Yeah,
I never saw it myself.
There was a character named Sweet Polly, and she would always say, oh, where is my underdog? Oh, where can he be? I'm no singer, so I won't quit my day job.
Yeah.
But every time when she would sing that song, underdog would fly to her rescue.
Yeah.
A friend of mine, actually, when she was a little girl, her brother pulled a very nasty little trick on her, and he talked her into getting into a dryer, for real. And he turned it on, and the thing that stopped the spinning in her head was her mother.
Yeah.
Her mother was just behind him, and I can't believe the mother would do it.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. She was a real Disney blonde when she came out,
my cat,
her hair was just all over
whom I adopted when she was about 9 months old, loved round things. Curled up in round baskets and round things. It was like that was perfection to her, just like the American natives, the roundness of things.
Uh-huh.
And one day I was busy doing laundry and I didn't have the door shut on my alcove, and she got into the dryer and she looked up at me and said, oh, Mom, this is just perfect. It's nice and cozy and it's round. And I grabbed that cat and I threw her several feet so that she wouldn't try to do that again.
Yeah.
It's just so cozy and it's round.
Yeah. Oh, what a wonderful world.
Yeah.
I'd like this song, yeah.
Okay, Patty.
I don't know the song.
Yeah, they used to play this on Easy 102
what
many
a
times.
Wonderful
yeah.
World.
Yeah.
Yes.
And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yeah, nobody sings Louis Armstrong like Louis.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
But, yeah, he just had that distinctive voice.
Mm-hmm.
You know, when I first heard that song, I was hoping he would have played his trumpet in the solo, but he didn't solo in that song. Because, you know, it was. I talked about this before. What was fun about Louis Armstrong to me was when he would do a trumpet solo, he didn't give you too much. He gave you, like, enough to where you'd want some more. Because, like, and I've said this before, all these jazz trumpet players are running a zillion notes song at some point.
Oh, yeah.
Just over and over and over. Louis just gave you, like, a little taste of it, you know.
He was into the jazz big time.
Well, yeah, but, you know, that was just fun. Because, you know, I'm not picking on bebop jazz, but that just works my nerves after.
Yeah, it works me. Yeah, definitely. Definitely.
It's just like every solo just. You can't even read.
You want a stronger melody.
I don't want my head dizzy from hearing all these.
It's kind of like the rat of Bumblebee.
Yeah, you listen to that about 20 times and you're going to be like, ready to fly home.
I know. I do love smooth jazz, though. That's on channel 943. Yeah. I heard that. That's like office music, on hold music. You know, when you're on hold at a certain company and they say, I love that smooth jazz. Sometimes he has piano or some other thing. It's just beautiful. And, you know, we really appreciate your business. A customer service representative will be here to assist you. Your estimated time to speak to a customer service representative is 6 minutes. And I hate it when they come on because I'm enjoying the music.
Right.
And smooth jazz, they have it on your music choices.
What's
music.
It's kind of like traditional rock and roll now.
Well, this is a song called Night Tunisia. This is one of those examples I was talking about just after they do the melody.
Yeah.
That's a beautiful melody, but then after they do that melody, like, the thing I don't like about jazz, they'll play a melody like Girl from Ipanema, right?
Yeah.
Then they take the chords to that song, and they're just making stuff up, and it's just all these, everybody's like, and then like a sandwich, and they go back and do the melody.
Yeah.
And the second song comes out, they do the same thing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And those solos just go on and on, because everybody takes a solo. The trumpet player, the sax player, the bass player, the drummer, and it works your nerves.
Mm-hmm.
At least to me it does.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the problem I have with that bebop jazz. And then you can't dance to that stuff like Glenn Miller and all that.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to pick on bebop. I mean, that's for some people. That's not necessarily for me.
Well, just like when the rock and roll from my era, which is around the 70s, late 60s and stuff. Now it's all classic rock, you know. And we were under the impression that the big bopper back then, Rock Around the Clock, and the Supremes and stuff, for classic rock, but now we've been moved to the elevator with Errol Smith and everybody, and they've got it under old classic rock now, so they have to modify it.
I've noticed that.
But the bad news is for a lot of people, because we have herbal medicines out there and good vitamins and stuff, a lot of us that are considered old, we're not really old. Just because you're past 29, you're not dead. You know, you still have life in you. Even though Simon Cowell was promoting that, saying, well, now that you're 29, you're too old for American Idol. You know, now we have The Voice instead of American Idol. Because a lot of people disagreed with that, which was good. Thank you, people. Thank you.
Rock and roll.
Yeah.
As long as you can. What the heck?
What was What was that Major Blake Shelton song? God Gave Me You.
I know of it, but I don't think I'd be able to play it. Oh. I like Blake Shelton. Did you see him on Saturday Night Live?
I like that.
Yeah, he did a great job on his appearance on Saturday Night Live. I thought it was very amusing.
Fascinating.
He recently was on Saturday Night Live. Yeah,
he
sang quite well.
Mm-hmm. I've never really watched Saturday Night Live. It's not
let's talk about that for a show.
It used to be a lot funnier, you know, the writers, but now. Yeah. They have to work hard because they're dealing with what they call now a lot of dry humor.
If you want to zero in on that more, their comedy is more on current world events.
And I don't mind that.
That's not always funny. I mean, like when you watch Letterman, I'm not trying to pick on Letterman, but like all these comedians, when they talk about world events, and like say somebody gets divorced or gets caught for fraud, they harp on that part of it. You know, somebody's misfortune is their comedy. And sometimes it's amusing, but sometimes it just isn't.
Yeah.
It's hard for me to watch regular TV a lot, but I find myself watching a lot of CW at the most because they endorse superheroes and things that make you know that the ordinary person does have an ability to be more than ordinary and can make a difference.
Well,
it's not really about the violence, and that's where they cornered Chuck Norris, and they were saying, you know, your movies, they promote a lot of violence. And he goes, well, if you understand, it's the underdog that's trying to get through the drama of whatever evil is out there. And sometimes you have to kick some shenanigans to get them out of the way to get to the good. You know, we can't let the bad overrun us. It's not.
thing to walk ticker. What is it? Texas Ranger.
Oh yeah, Walker
Ranger.
Texas Ranger. Yeah.
Chuck Norris actually.
Yeah.
Chuck Norris actually tried to sing the theme song. Mm. It was interesting.
He was very well. Actually, if you look, I watched a fascinating movie last night called Appaloosa, and it was probably made in the late 70s. It starred Ed Harris.
Who?
Ed Harris.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I know
him. It was, and I'm sorry, I can't remember the other names right now, but the point of it was, violence was a way of life in the Old West.
Yeah.
And unless you could be a threat to someone else and you could just knock them out of the picture, they were constantly sniping at you or making life miserable.
Yeah.
And a lot of it was, too, basically, people back then didn't have money all the time.
Mm-hmm.
There was no real, like now it's just everywhere and all this crazy stuff. But back then it wasn't. So whatever you got, you had to be a person of your word and be honest and dependable. No question about it.
Yeah.
And if you were selling horses, you had to be an honest horse seller.
Yeah.
If you ran a bank, you had to be honest with that. You couldn't touch somebody else's money. You had to behave yourself.
Yeah.
You know, and you had to stand your ground.
Mm-hmm.
Getting
you
back
know,
to Saturday Night Live real quick.
And
for
that's
a second.
Why I championed Montana Vigilantes.
Mm-hmm.
Now, getting back to Saturday Night Live for a second.
Good job.
When that show first came out, they didn't do world events like the current Saturday Night Live. They had characters like John Belushi did his version of the Hulk.
Uh-huh.
And Samurai
Laundry.
Stuff
like that. And, you know, and those were like really funny characters, but as time went by, because that, you know, Saturday Night Live's been on for like 40 years now.
Yeah.
Their comedy started changing from the time they had like John Belushi and all the original cast to they do current
Jane
events
Curtin.
Now,
yeah.
You know. They don't do the cone heads and all that really funny stuff anymore.
Right. Well, when they began to,
mostly,
they were in an apartment.
I did like Not Ready for Primetime Players, though.
Yeah, I know. But I mean, we're talking over a 40-year period. Because when you watch Saturday Night Live now, they're always doing world events and stuff.
Yeah, and it's limited.
And
the skits are more limited,
more
too.
Serious and a little bit more of a political edge.
Yeah, and sometimes they kind of cross that line.
So it's
a
almost
bit,
all
too.
Satire instead of.
And it's not a lot of variety either.
But, you know, Saturday Night Live is just such an institution that they'll just run that show anyway.
Oh, yeah.
I think
but
they need some,
you know.
Maybe a little bit more open variety and more hilarious people like Robin Williams in a sense, because then their mind keeps going and going and the comedy can keep pouring out. When you have people that are dry humor, we'll say, their perception is with blinders. They're not open to everything and how things can be funny all the time, you know. And I understand that once, because I'm mildly dyslexic. So if somebody says something and it's trying to bring me down, I can actually find the opposite of it right away and turn it around, you know. But you have to look. You have to really research what is being put out there.
Yeah. I do like political humor. Like I liked Jay Leno when he would do political humor.
Oh, yes.
Jay Leno was good. I didn't like all the stuff he did, but I liked his political humor, you know.
Yeah, yeah. Well, he looked like Dudley Do-Right. He always looked like Dudley. He has that chin. He should actually be doing Dudley Do-Right. I mean, Leslie Nielsen did a movie of it, but they should do Dudley Do-Right too and have Jay Leno play Dudley Do-Right, because he's Dudley Do-Right.
Well, somebody has already played Dudley Do-Right in the
movie.
That
was Leslie Nielsen.
No, I'm talking about the actual Dudley Do-Right film. That was Brendan Fraser, the actor. He plays Dudley Do-Right with Sarah Jessica Parker.
Oh, well, then Les Nielsen was Mr. Magoo then. He played it Mr. Magoo.
Yeah, I remember
Because they
Mr.
both
Magoo.
Came out at the same time.
But anyway, getting backtracking, we'll talk about Mr. Magoo in a second. Saturday Night Live, their humor has changed over the years.
Uh-huh.
But if you're a Saturday Night Live fan, cool.
Yeah.
But getting back to Mr. Magoo, I used to watch Mr. Magoo when I was a kid growing up.
Oh, yeah, Mr.
And,
Magoo. I remember now.
And
yes,
what was
yes.
funny about
James
that?
James Bacchus
was
a blind old
voice.
Man.
Yeah,
that
Jim Bacchus
got
was, yeah, he was
done.
A voice.
Yes.
And, you know, he had a sidekick what? Named Charlie that couldn't speak English very well. So instead of Charlie calling him boss, he called him Bloss.
Mm-hmm.
And I always thought that was amusing. And Charlie would always kind of save the day because Mr. Magoo couldn't see.
Yeah.
And, that was just quite a cartoon.
I used to like Fractured Fairy Tales.
Yeah.
Don't remember them.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
You gotta hook into
the thing about
vintage.
Mr. Magoo, I remember too. He was always blind wherever he went, but he got his tasks done.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody was just, you know, you'd expect him to bump into things.
You're gonna get sick from eating.
I don't remember the middle part. Let me do that again. That was the theme song to Mr. Magoo. Yeah. Well, you know, they don't make cartoons like that anymore.
Yeah.
And
we'll
so,
have to start the new ones because somebody's got to do it.
Yeah.
Well, that would be cool. Yeah, you get a job as a cartoonist, maybe you make a new cartoon one day
or something.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I watched
we all have a
Mr.
Superhero
Magoo
inside our house.
And, oh gosh, there were a lot of other cartoons at that time that were fun.
I used to watch the Monster Mash. Not people remember that one, but it was basically, you had the Frankenstein, Dracula, the werewolf, put all them in there, and they had their own rock band.
I guess I don't know that one.
They're pretty cool.
Yeah.
But nothing still compares to the really perfected Disney animated musicals like
Well, that
Dumbo.
Might be true, but I was more of a Warner
Dumbo
Brothers.
Dumbo and Pinocchio just...
Mm-hmm. I was more of the Warner Brothers guy, you know, Daffy Duck and Bugs Bunny.
I liked them all.
Tweety.
I never cared for those. Yeah, I've seen them many
Sylvester.
Times.
Sylvester.
Yeah, that those
never
were
cared
Warner
for me,
Brother. The Warner Brothers.
I loved Bugs Bunny. Bugs Bunny was my favorite.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
And Yosemite Sam reminds me of the average public now. Really.
Darn, there was a. It was a show for kids that was Warner Brothers based. It was a cartoon back in the late 80s, I guess it was.
Schoolhouse Rock was little shorts. But
oh, I remember Schoolhouse. Let's have fun with that.
Those were films that were used for education. But I'm talking about now.
Well, PBS had Magic School Bus. That was another good one.
Well, yeah, but that,
you
again,
know
it was
nope.
educational. This was on regular television. And did you know that I was Miss Frizzle?
Oh, were you really?
No. Students would call me that when I did my summer substituting.
Oh.
The elementary students would say, "We have Miss Frizzle today."
Uh-huh. Okay, that was figure eight from the Schoolhouse Rock. I don't know if you remember Schoolhouse Rock.
Nope.
In the 70s, they had these educational cartoons that were like about a minute or two long.
Uh-huh.
That
like
started at the top of the hour, like intermission before the next show.
Oh, yeah.
And they
had
like math and history and English and all that. And one of those was figure eight. The theme song that I played just now, which of course is my personal favorite, Schoolhouse Rock.
Huh.
The most recent Saturday Night Live, not to go back to that again, but was actually making fun of the one, "I'm Just a Bill."
Oh, I saw that.
It was hilarious. The guy goes, "Oh, we don't do that anymore." He pushes the bill down. He's, you know, going down.
Yeah.
He gets back up. He goes, "Okay, man, I'm going to go." And then they go, "No, now we have lobbyists." And they knock the bill down again.
Yeah, well, see, the original "I'm Just a Bill," that was sung by Jack Sheldon, the jazz trumpeter.
Mm-hmm.
And they were explaining how laws are made. You become a bill first, and if the president signs your law.
Uh-huh.
So when Saturday Night Live did their version, they had the actor put on the paper roll, like in the cartoon, and they kept pushing him down the stairs because it was different.
And this kid goes, "Now what do we do if you knock the bills out?" "Oh," and then it's President Obama going, "Oh, we have another measure now."
Originally, these were educational cartoons, Schoolhouse Rock, and the most popular Schoolhouse Rock is Conjunction Junction.
Yeah,
you heard that Conjunction Junction?
You played it one time, but
your
I never will.
Hooking up phrases and clauses together. I'm no singer, but anyway, that's the most number one.
And you know that I used to use that in my classroom, and it shows the students very clearly the five different kinds of conjunctions, and they go, "Wow, I get it now."
Something like that. But that's the number one Schoolhouse Rock of all time, of all of them that they did. It was called Conjunction Junction. And Jack Sheldon, again, was the voice to that. And, you know, when that first came out, Schoolhouse Rock won the Children's Awards. It beat Sesame Street that year when it first came out.
Interesting.
Yeah, it did. It was the number one. And they did, like, math, history, English, and all the rest. And so this figure eight, this one,
Because I was one of the first Sesame Street kids. I was hooked on Sesame Street when I was 5. It's like, my day would not go right without Sesame Street. You know, it just wouldn't, you know.
Yeah, but no, when Schoolhouse Rock came out, they won in the Children's Awards. And Blossom Dearie, the jazz pianist, was the voice for Figure 8. Hmm. She did Figure 8, Mother Necessity, and Unpack Your Adjectives. Mm-hmm. And she sounded like a little girl, see? And that's why it worked, because she was really a jazz singer and a jazz pianist. So when she would sound like a little girl singing, it worked.
Interesting, yeah.
But yeah, that Figure 8's pretty cool how she sings that. So if you get a chance to see that, just put Figure 8 Schoolhouse Rock on YouTube and you can see or hear Blossom Dearie and see the cartoon images of that. And they got this figure skater. She's like daydreaming in class, figure skating. Her teacher gets up to her, catches her daydreaming, so she wakes up. Then they talk about what, you know, 1 × 8 is 8, 2 × 8 is 16, 3 × 8 is 24, 4 × 8 is 32, 5 × 8 is 40. I got that memorized.
Yeah.
6 × 8 is 48, 7 × 8 is 56, 8 × 8 is 64, 9 × 8 is 72, and 10 × 8 is 80. That's true.
Yeah, interesting.
11 × 8 is 88, and 12 × 8 is 96. Boy, I'm pretty good, ain't I? Nah, let me stop. I was terrible at math. I was terrible at math.
Yes.
The only reason why I know my 8-time tables is because of Schoolhouse Rock. Yeah. And I got it memorized, watch it about a zillion times.
Which makes me think of one thing.
Uh-huh.
Anybody who knows math can understand logic. And the other thing is, Mozart is the classic musician when they want to increase a child's ability to reason, do math, and logic.
Mm-hmm. Well, they did say that for good memorization. If you sing your schoolwork,
yes,
you'll memorize it better.
Exactly.
Because of the tune, subconscious.
Yeah.
Sing it, you'll remember it. And that's why...
That's just such catchy little tune,
I figured out...
Yeah.
I am an audio learner because if I hear something, I can remember it. And I realize that's not everybody's learning style, but audio learning is a big part of our lives.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, and I have friends particularly, I'm 66 now, and I have friends who are, you know, upwards of 100 years old. They miss a great deal of life with their hearing loss.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't matter how you try to replace it.
Yes.
It's much more important than visual loss.
Yes.
So it really moves me profoundly when I encounter people who have hearing loss and realize what they're missing.
Yeah.
Well, I did notice when I was a teacher's aide over at Head Start, and I'd have like 15 to 30 children between the ages of 4 to 6 around me, which I loved. I just couldn't get enough. But to keep the mischievous little ones, there was always at least 3 or 4 in the bunch, and as you're a teacher, you know this, that just lose interest quickly. So what I would have to do when I told a story is I would have to animate my voice when I talked to two different characters. And that seemed to work the best. But the side effect was the regular teachers kind of got jealous, because when I would come in the next day, the children, instead of lining up with the teachers, would go, "Oh, teacher, run to me." And I'd get the whack of it.
Well, I think I was just trying to pick that out. So that's just my little feeble attempt to play Figure 8 the Schoolhouse Rock. But again, that's my personal favorite Schoolhouse Rock of all the Schoolhouse
Rock. Do you ice skate?
Everybody has a... Well, I tried ice skating, and that wasn't for me.
I tried rollerblading, and I didn't even leave the aisle.
I got tired of falling on my backside and hurting myself.
That's what
skating.
Happened.
What was that? That was ice.
Ice skating. Yeah, ice skating.
I used to when I was young.
Because they had the ice skater on Figure 8, you know. So
we used to have the clamp-on roller skates when I was growing up.
Oh, I remember that.
And,
are they tie-on?
I would roller skate down the sidewalk reading a book.
Oh, that's coordinated. That's really coordinated.
I didn't want to lose my place in the book just because I was roller skating.
Yeah.
That was a while
I appreciate
ago.
The singing on that Figure 8. Pretty cool. I was trying to... Well, She's the
same. I used to watch it all the time.
Well, everybody in the 70s watched Schoolhouse Rock.
Interesting, yeah.
I have the entire Schoolhouse Rock collection at home.
Oh, cool.
It did help me through school.
Yeah.
A lot of things.
Really, I
until
was
terrible.
Until
you get to higher grades,
you know?
And that was another one. They needed High School Rock after that.
Then,
you know?
Did you ever like Hap Palmer? Have you ever heard of Hap Palmer? He was one of the first, I don't know if he was one of the first children's artists, but I used to take Child Development 1 in high school.
Mm-hmm.
I was hooked on Hap Palmer. He played the guitar, but this was for preschoolers, you know, 3 to 5, but I mean, if you can ever get, I didn't like his newer stuff. I wonder if they still have his old stuff from the 60s and early 70s.
Do. I would, my guess would probably
archives.
Be on YouTube.
Because I do have some of his records and tapes, and you know, he was excellent guitarist. Dun, 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 dun. Make a way for this parade of colors. They are marching all around. When you sound of the bell, all stand up and all sit down. Dun, 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 red stand up. Blue, stand up, yep. Run, run, stand up. Oh, I just love that. And oh, triangle, circle, and square. Triangle, circle, and square.
Uh-huh.
And something. Dun, 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 dun. Can anyone show me? Because it was interactive for the preschool.
I really don't know
they
that one.
Fantastic. I just love
bands.
It.
Well, when I was a boy, it was Captain Kangaroo. You probably
oh, I remember Captain
it
Kangaroo.
Was Captain
my
Kangaroo
yes.
with Sherry Lewis and Lamb Chop. And that was my first
Rabbit.
Thing.
Uh-huh. Yeah, Mr. Rabbit.
She had the little socks, the
yep.
she had lamb chop.
Uh-huh.
At least have fun with that. You know the song, Patty?
I've heard it. It's been a while.
Yeah, I don't like Hap Palmer's newer stuff, but his older stuff I loved, you know.
He just does it over and over. That's called The Song That Never Ends.
Mm-hmm.
They have a number of children's bands, like the Tubbies came on. I don't really like them that much, but they're great for the little kids. We're talking
the Teletubbies?
About. Yeah.
Oh, I hate the Teletubbies.
Between,
yeah, I know. I wasn't
like
a big fan
of
that.
Like 2 to like almost 4, that audience is perfect for them.
Yeah.
But they've got, there's a few that's coming out now that they've tried to focus on with the younger kids to older. I mean, just like
well, you know, the children's stuff for today is different than when I was a boy.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know the purple dinosaur? What's the one?
Yeah,
you
Barney.
Barney.
Oh,
yeah. Barney.
I really never liked Barney. And one Christmas, my children got a whole bunch of Barney stuff, and I want to thank the people that gave them that because we got to exchange them and get them what they really wanted.
Yeah, but no, it was
we
fun.
We like purple.
But
you guys are making me feel ancient.
Well, it was
you're
fun. It was
about.
Fun watching Sherry Lewis. My mom would send me to school after I would watch Sherry Lewis when I was in the first grade, and she had long hair back then too. Well, she was so much younger. Sherry Lewis, yeah, Lamb Chop. Well, they were more primitive.
Lamb Chop.
Yeah, they were primitive when I was
boy.
A little boy, and then that show evolved over the years to what we remember Sherry Lewis and Lamb Chop now. And they always sing that song, "This is the song that never ends. Mm-hmm. It goes on and on,
yeah,
my
I
friend."
That.
Something like that.
Interesting.
And it just keeps doing it over and over and over. And Sherry would kick Charlie Horse out and say, "Charlie, stop singing that song."
We had Puff and Stuff, Captain Kangaroo.
Oh, I remember H.R. Puff and Stuff.
Oh, I remember that, too. After Land of the Lost, yes.
The Hudson Brothers, we had the Hudson Brothers.
Let me do that. H.R. Puff and Stuff, doesn't it?
Yeah,
I know. We did. We lose the actor that played the boy with the magic flute.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, we lost him in real life years ago. But, they had a character named Witchy Pooh. She was a nasty little ugly-looking witch. And she was always trying to get that magic flute, and H.R. Puff and Stuff would tell that boy, "You keep that flute because that witch wants that flute." It's similar to The Wizard of Oz, you know?
Yeah,
and
yeah.
When the witch wanted the slippers.
What did you guys think of Welcome Back, Cotter?
That's supposed
to
be
teach you?
Yeah, that was supposed to be.
I never watched it.
They're airing that now these days.
I watched that, but that was after I'd been teaching for about 10 years.
Yeah, so you can kind of read that going, well, okay, it's kind of like this, and it's kind of.
Yeah, I never watched Welcome Back, Carter. I've heard of it, but I've never watched it.
You know what I liked about that show? John Travolta's character was amusing to me on that show. He was like the lead character, a very young John Travolta.
The funny one was the Jewish one with the accent.
Yeah, I know, he was, it was kind of a goofy little comedy. They were all in school.
Oh.
And Mr. Cotter was their teacher.
Well,
you know, and they grew up in this like rough neighborhood. They made comedy of it, but
I think I know the words to some of that song.
Which one?
Welcome Back, Cotter.
Alright, let's try it.
Who is you always coming from? Welcome back. Everybody knows your name.
Yeah, but that show was kind of amusing to me. But like anything else, when the novelty wears off and it gets old and times change and shows in. Now, we just lost the actress recently that played Mrs. Cotter on the series. We just lost her recently.
Yeah, she's taking her nap.
The actress that played Mrs. Cotter. We lost her about 2 months ago.
Oh, really?
Something like that. Yeah.
She was awesome.
By the way, I was thinking, we were back at Lawrence Welk, you were talking one of the shows that I was, one of the shows that I was on, we were talking about how many of the Welk stars are dead. I was going to ask you, now I finally remember the question, Anna Connie, you remember Anna Connie?
Good-looking singer, yeah.
Yeah, is she? Did she pass away?
I don't think so. I looked her up recently. I think she's still singing.
She was the one who tried to get me an audition.
Yeah, you told that. Would you tell that story again? Yeah, the real Anna Connie.
She lived where I lived at the Salvation Army Evangel and Resident for Women in downtown Los Angeles. Mm-hmm. And she knew that I was singing. She'd heard me practicing and things. But I was working on operas, and I was caught up in my roles and everything and rehearsing those. And she knew that I was looking for a car, and I didn't realize who she was because I didn't watch Lawrence Welk at that time. That was something I just didn't like TV that much, and other people watched it. I didn't know who she was, but she told me that she had a car that a friend might be selling me, and would I like to ride in it with her and see if I wanted to buy it. So I said sure, because I had had trouble finding a car that I could get financing for. And mine had been rear-ended on the freeway by a person who was driving under the influence of something without insurance and driving a stolen vehicle. So
that's a double whammy. Well, triple whammy, I guess.
Yeah. Anyway, so she didn't tell me where she was taking me. She took me to a place on La Brea that was La Via Taxco was right near where the old Charlie Chaplin studios were, and she took me to this club and she said, okay, you're going to audition now, and you just go up there and sing something more modern and current. And I just couldn't think of anything, and
you're focused on opera.
I was like dear eyes in the headlights, and so I went up on this little stage, and there was a man sitting in the back with a white hat, a white suit, and waistcoat, and jacket, with white shoes, taking off his white gloves, and I sang "I Left My Heart in San Francisco,"
but it wasn't Michael Jackson,
as well as I could, and I just didn't put it together until after I did this, and she wasn't really interested in selling me a car. She just wanted me to give me a chance to audition for Lawrence Welk.
Wow.
But if she had told me, I would have known who it was.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
You know, so
that's why you just have to be prepared, you know. You just have to be prepared.
You never know.
Well, I know now.
I know now, me too.
Well, see, and you were focusing on opera. When you sing opera, that's all different song there. That's like, that's a play with music, so you've got to vocalize differently. It's not like turning on the rock station waiting for contemporary rock. You've got to actually be ready for drama.
This is such a cool song. Probably had high standards. Uh-huh. Is what I've heard.
Yeah,
and that's
did.
Why his show was so tight. And sometimes I think
sure
when
I
you have a show,
good.
Well, you never know. I mean, a person could be good, but just not prepared.
So you're supposed to do opera and Broadway at the same time. That's insane.
But you know, he had high standards, and that's why his show was so good. And when we do this new Lawrence Welk, I'll probably have those same standards. I'm just not going to settle.
So know
for,
when you're on the audition and be prepared.
And be prepared. And on that note, it's time to sign out, and you know, the whole hour's gone by again so quickly.
Amazing.
Yeah, I know, it's really amazing. So
happy trails to you.
We're going to do some final acknowledgments and sign off for this segment of Asaph Cafe, and we have Emmett, our guest today, on my left.
Uh-huh.
Thanks for appearing on both shows. You'll see yourself a few weeks from now. And then our guest again, Linda Brooks Curtis. Our veteran guest on my right, Hostess of Asaph Cafe, Patty Reed, and of course our mascot Pee-wee. And I think Pee-wee's been very active
in
this show today.
And thank you again, PBS and Celtic Women, for taking the time to make us very entertained with your Irish celebration.
And on that note,
hasta la vista,
bye.
And on that note, ladies and gentlemen, until our next show, Maranatha.
And Lord willing, next time we will get to my love of new age music or contemporary instrumental, some other things. Yep. Absolutely, yep.
Yeah, we'll see, maybe.
Yeah.
If not new age, we'll talk about something.
This guy's in love with you.
Yeah. Well, it doesn't mean the new age movement.
I know.
Yeah.
Loves
yeah.
Bad,
yep. Oh, yeah.
Finish the song, this will be the end of it.
Yep.
This is my personal theme song.
Yep.
And it's the theme song to this show, too.
This guy's in love with this show.
Of course I love the show.
Yeah.
It's his baby.
It's my baby.
But funny, there wasn't a long enough blanket to wrap it.
Catch in the funny papers.
And I'm going to freeze on that chord right there. Thank you again for being our guest. Maranatha, ladies and gentlemen.
Mm-hmm.
Ciao, Miss Morgan.
Bugatti. Lonnie Stones. All right, I've got to get a